Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Jill Robbins and John Russell. Later, Dan Novak presents this week's education report. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day from John Russell. He explains the meaning and usages of the word thieves. But first, here is Jill Robbins.
Some people seem to be born with skill for making art. Ace-Liam Ankrah of Ghana is a good example. He recently set a world record for his painting, and he is not even 2 years old. Last week, the Guinness Book of World Records named little Ace-Liam the world's youngest male artist. His mother, Chantel Kukua Egan, says the baby's art started by accident when her son discovered her acrylic paints. He was 6 months old at the time. Egan is 25 years old and is an artist herself and founder of Arts and Cocktails Studio in Ghana's capital, Accra. The business offers drinks and painting lessons. Egan said she was looking for a way to keep her boy busy while working on her own paintings. I spread out a canvas on the floor and added paint to it, and then in the process of crawling, he ended up spreading all the colors on the canvas. And that is how his first artwork, The Crawl, was born, Egan told the Associated Press. After that, and with his mother's support, Ace-Liam continued making paintings. Egan decided to apply for the record from Guinness a year ago. In November 2023, the organization told her that to break her record, her son needed to publicly show and sell his paintings. She set up Ace-Liam's first show at the Museum of Science and Technology in Accra in January. She entered 10 of his paintings and 9 sold. Then Guinness World Records made the announcement, declaring, at the age of 1 year, 152 days, little Ace-Liam Nanasem Ankrah from Ghana is the world's youngest male artist. The overall record for the world's youngest artist is currently held by India's Arushi Bhatnagar. She had her first exhibition at the age of 11 months and sold her first painting for $60 in 2003. Ace-Liam will be 2 years old in July. He still loves painting and joining his mom in her art space, where he has his own work area. He sometimes paints for just 5 minutes at a time, returning to the same canvas over days or weeks, Egan says. On a recent day, he ran around the workspace with energy usual for children his age. But he also painted for almost an hour, his small fingers spreading the paint on the canvas. Egan says becoming a world record holder has not changed their lives. She will not sell The Crawl, she says. She wants to keep it in the family. She also says she hopes the media attention around her boy would push other parents to discover and support skills their children may have. Of Ace-Liam, she added, he is painting and growing and playing in the whole process. I'm Jill Robbins.
Very small organisms that live in the world's farm fields release nitrous oxide gas. Some scientists link the gas to climate change. They are looking for a way to deal with the issue. Now, some researchers think they have found bacteria that can help reduce the amount of nitrous oxide released. In a recent publication of Nature, scientists said tests in the laboratory and in the field showed that one kind of bacteria reduced nitrous oxide without hurting other microbes in the soil. The bacteria also survived well in soil and would not be very costly to produce. Lars Bakken is with the Norwegian University of Life Sciences. He was one of the writers of the study. Bakken said, "It opens up a number of new possibilities in bioengineering of the farmed soil." The Associated Press reports that nitrous oxide can warm the atmosphere 265 times more than an equal amount of carbon dioxide. Nitrous oxide can remain in the atmosphere for more than 100 years. Farmers' use of nitrogen fertilizer drives up the amount of nitrous oxide produced in soil. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency said that, in 2022, nitrous oxide made up 6% of all U.S. greenhouse gas emissions from human activities. "That is a big problem in agriculture," said Lori Hoagland of Purdue University in the state of Indiana. Hoagland was not involved in the recent study. She described the plan to reduce nitrous oxide as really interesting. Bakken and other researchers used organic waste to grow their bacteria. Building on past work, the researchers looked for a microorganism that would last long enough to reduce nitrous oxide emissions without staying in the soil so long that it hurt other life forms that are important for crop health. In field tests, the researchers used robots to measure nitrous oxide emissions during the day and during the night. They compared conditions in soil with and without the bacteria. Researchers found the bacteria reduced the nitrous oxide emissions of the first fertilizer treatment by 94%. 2 weeks later, the bacteria reduced the emissions of a second fertilizer treatment by about half. After about 3 months, there was no difference in the makeup of microbial life forms. This suggested to the researchers that their bacteria would not change or hurt the soil. The bacteria that researchers used is found naturally in anaerobic digesters, machines that are already being used to turn organic waste products like cow manure into biofuels. The researchers said the bacteria are not genetically modified. That might ease acceptance of their use, said Paul Carini of the University of Arizona. Carini was also not involved in the research. Bakken said the bacteria could be included in some fertilizers on farms in 3 to 4 years if people think it is worth the cost. Carini thinks using the bacteria is worth it. "Anytime you are using a waste product from one industry to benefit another industry, that's pretty cost-effective," he said. However, Bakken pointed out that farmers are not paid for reducing nitrous oxide emissions. He thinks there must be additional incentives for emissions reductions. "The task for the authorities is to install policy instruments that makes it profitable in one way or another, he said. Hoagland, the Purdue professor, said more research in field conditions would likely be needed before the bacteria could be used worldwide. That is because soil is different in places around the world. If they can get this to work across soils, it would just have a tremendous impact, for sure, she said. I'm John Russell.
There are programs in the United States that aim to support families with their children's early learning and development. Home visiting programs try to improve early education at a low cost. The programs might expand with new federal money. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, or HHS, follows home visiting programs to see how effective they are and provides information about them on its website. Isabel Valencia got experience with a home visiting program in 2022. During a trip to buy food with her two young children, somebody told Valencia about a program. She had moved to Pueblo, Colorado a few months earlier and was feeling lonely. She had not met anyone else who spoke Spanish. She learned about the Home Instruction for Parents of Preschool Youngsters program, or HIPPY. HIPPY says it provides families with a trained support person who visits their home every week. The group shows them how to interact with their children using developmental activities. The HIPPY program uses regular home visits and monthly group meetings to help parents learn how to improve early literacy and social and emotional skills. The workers went through the program themselves and often share the same language and background as the families they serve. The program operates mostly in poor neighborhoods and through school districts and organizations for immigrant and refugee families, said Miriam Westheimer. She is chief program officer for HIPPY International, which operates in 15 countries and 20 U.S. states. HHS has a program to provide money for maternal, infant, and early childhood home visiting, or MICV, models. The agency has approved about 24 home visiting models. Some aim to help preschool children. Others send social workers or nurses to support maternal and child health. An estimated 17 million families nationwide could receive home visiting services. But in 2022, only about 270,000 did. That is because the programs do not get enough money, said Dr. Michael Warren of the Maternal and Child Health Bureau. That office oversees the MICV programs. If more resources exist, more families can be served, he said. Federal spending on the MICV program is set to double from $400 million to $800 million yearly by 2027. Beginning this year, the federal government will match $3 for every $1 in non-federal money spent on home visiting programs, up to a limit. Home visitors supply books and materials to parents for developmental activities. They also supply diapers and help them find food pantries, public assistance programs, and mental health professionals. They also explain the importance of talking, reading, and singing with young children, asking them questions, and praising them. The home visitors also communicate a simple but important message to parents. Everything they need to help their children succeed is probably already at home. A math lesson can be found among a bag of beans or a pocket of coins. Kids can practice reading skills by searching for objects around the house that start with a certain letter. The most valuable thing families and home visitors say is the connection between parent and child. Parents also become better advocates for themselves and their children. Research suggests that children who went through home visiting programs are better prepared for school. Home visiting is not meant to be a replacement for other early learning experiences. But supporters say it can help create a strong foundation, especially for the many families which find early education programs too costly. Maria Chavez Contreras is a home visiting program manager at the community-based organization that hosts Hippie in Pueblo. She said kindergarten teachers say students who receive home visiting services have longer attention spans, follow instructions better, and have more developed motor skills. Fatima Zamani is a home visitor based in Denver, Colorado, who emigrated from Afghanistan in 2016. The parents she works with are all recent immigrant arrivals from Afghanistan. She said the kindergarten teachers are impressed with the children. Her own 4-year-old daughter is in the Hippie program. She can say the alphabet, count, and identify shapes and colors. She is ready for preschool, Zamani says. I'm Dan Novak.
Dan Novak joins me now to talk more about today's education report. Hi, Dan. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley.
Today's story was about home visiting programs for parents of young children. How do these differ from more traditional child care services?
As many American parents know, child care can be very expensive. The think tank Center for American Progress says child care for an infant costs an average of $16,000 a year. That is 21% of the median income for a family of three. That would include services like nannies or daycare. So yeah, really costly. Home visiting is not around-the-clock child care, but trained professionals go into homes and work with parents with babies to give them advice on things like breastfeeding or how to get babies safely asleep. For older toddlers, they teach parents how to be supportive in helping them read or play, for example. These programs are often free of charge and supported by the Federal Department of Health and Human Services. As I mentioned in the story, many immigrant families have been able to take advantage of home visiting services. Between work and other responsibilities, it can be hard for some parents to center all their attention on their children. Recent immigrants might not be familiar with the American education system and might not know the best way to prepare their children for kindergarten. So for now, home visiting services are mostly targeted towards recent immigrants or poorer families.
You note in the story that about 17 million families nationwide could receive home visiting services. But in 2022, only about 270,000 did. Why is that?
Yes, these programs have been proven to help prepare children for school and strengthen relationships between parents and children. But a relatively small number of families have used home visiting services. That is because of a lack of funding. Smaller local organizations need to operate home visiting programs, like the one mentioned in the story from Colorado. But without enough funding, those local organizations are not able to operate. But yearly funding for the home visiting program is set to double to $800 million by 2027. Experts say that large increase should get more parents to take advantage of the program.
All right. Thanks so much for joining me today, Dan.
You're welcome, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
In this next report, Dan Friedel tells us about how criminals are using technology to steal cars. We learn about a few steps people can take to protect cars from being stolen. Pay careful attention to the word thieves. We will talk more about the term after the report.
Most recent cars have an electronic key that lets the owner get into and start the car. The electronic key is called a fob to those who know about the technology. The fob sends a short-range signal to the car. As the owner gets close, the fob unlocks the door. But the new technology also makes it easier for criminals to open the car without the key. When you lock your car and take the key with you inside your home, the fob does not stop sending its signal. Thieves who have special equipment known as scanners will pass by streets with a lot of cars. If the scanner shows that a fob is sending a signal, the thieves use a device that clones the signal and opens the car doors. Government officials around the world have asked car makers to warn car buyers of the risks of the new technology. They also have asked them to make the fobs more secure. Until then, what can you do to prevent your car from being stolen? Steve Launchbury has some suggestions he shared with the Associated Press. He is the head engineer of automotive security company Thatcham Research, based in Britain. It's relatively easy for drivers to protect themselves, he said. The first tip is to put your key into a protective container or bag when you get home. One kind is called a Faraday bag. They are not very costly. The bag is made from a special metal material called mesh that blocks the signal from the fob. Just do not forget to put any extra keys you have into that bag, too. Some advice that is easy to find online says people should put their keys into the microwave or freezer to prevent their signal from being stolen. Launchbury said that does not work and it could harm your key. You may have seen large locks that go across the steering wheel in television advertisements many years ago. It turns out they are still useful. They may be considered old school, but the presence of big locks that are easy to see makes car thieves turn away. The only problem is that you must take extra time to unlock the device and put it away before you can drive away. Some car makers permit owners to deactivate the signals sent out by the fob. For Ford, Honda, and Audi, owners can use their car's touchscreen system to find the correct way to turn off the signal. For Toyota, you can turn off the signal by pressing a combination of buttons on the fob. Read your car's owner's manual to be sure how to do this. Some car makers include motion sensors on their key fobs. If the fob has not been moved in a while, the fob turns off. If you buy a used car, some experts suggest that you get your keys reprogrammed in case the earlier owner still has a key. Launchbury said, some cars have a new system called a Controller Area Network, or CAN. The network permits different parts or components of the car to communicate with each other. He said, some thieves are trying to join the CAN through some physical electronic connection to unlock the car. They can do this by removing a headlight and plugging in a device that lets them in the car's network. The device can send a signal such as unlock or start to the central system. Launchbury said, this is where the physical lock can cause thieves to change their mind and force them to move on. Owners can also consider electronic immobilizers. These devices prevent a car from moving even if a thief gets into the internal system. However, immobilizers can be costly. I'm Dan Friedel.
Before the report, we asked you to pay careful attention to the word thieves. Can you remember when you heard it? You heard the term used several times in the report. Let's listen to the first example.
Thieves who have special equipment known as scanners will pass by streets with a lot of cars.
The word thieves is a plural noun. We spell thieves like this. T-H-I-E-V-E-S. The singular form of thieves is thief. We spell thief like this. T-H-I-E-F. A thief is a person who steals something. When one thief works with another thief, we get two thieves. Both the singular thief and the plural thieves have the same vowel sound, e. Thief, thieves. The big difference between the two words is the consonant or consonant sounds at the end of the word. Thief ends in the consonant sound f. This is a voiceless sound. In other words, you should not feel your vocal cords moving when you pronounce it. Thieves ends with two consonant sounds, vz. These are both voiced consonant sounds. You should feel your vocal cords move when you pronounce these sounds. Let's work together to improve our pronunciation of thief and thieves. We will start with the last sound in thief. Repeat after me. F. F. Eef. Eef. Thief. Thief. Now we will do thieves. Repeat after me. Z. Z. Vzz. Vzz. Eves. Eves. Thieves. Thieves. And that's the lesson of the day. I'm John Russell.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.